On Hot Copy this morning, how will the economy recover after the pandemic? Will 2021 be a better year for the Philippines? We have with us Socioeconomic Planning Secretary Carl Chua. Secretary Chua, good morning to you.
Good morning, Karen. Good morning to all the viewers.
And I want to thank you for finally being on Head Start as NEDA Chief. I think I've been inviting you for over a year. Huh?
Thank you very much, Karen, for waiting. It was quite challenging, actually, when I started with the greatest crisis of our history in a decade, no, in a century. And then when the school year started, I had to school my five-year-old son. So apologies and thank you for your patience.
No, but that's admirable. Also, working father at NEDA and very involved. Let's get down to business, economic recovery. We're talking about a 9.5% contraction. And let's start first. You're quite optimistic. And tell me if this is still what you think, that for 2021, the Philippine economy can grow by 7.5%?
Well, for 2021, the Development Budget and Coordination Committee has projected a 6.5 to 7.5% growth. And by 2022, an 8 to 10% growth. So in other words, we will recover to pre-pandemic levels or 2019 levels sometime in 2022. And Karen, let me emphasize that this is not going to be easy, but it will happen if we do three things. Okay, so number one, we manage the risk, open the economy as safely as we can, and not be totally risk averse, which happened last year. The second is we have a package of recovery measures, so we have to implement them in an accelerated manner. And number three, and most importantly, we deploy our vaccination program as fast as we can. Of course, that depends on the supply. So all of these will actually help us in our recovery this year and even better next year.
Okay, let's talk about the three. You said don't be risk averse, and that's quite good because recently at a forum, the PCCI commented on the frequent changing of community quarantine classifications, compounded by what they say is unclear government communications, sporadic changes in policy guidelines, and inconsistent implementation of regulation and mobility controls. And that is a direct quote. How can the government, or how should the government change managing the pandemic the rest of 2021 for us to see this 6.5 to 7.5% growth? What should they change, Secretary?
Well, in the first place, the government has been learning quite a lot from our experience last year. You know, Karen, when we started in March with the COVID-19 pandemic, we were all afraid and everything was so uncertain. And we had to shut down 75% of the economy. We didn't even open public transport. We kept everyone at home, okay? Then the result was really the figures that we saw last year. Economy contracted by its worst, job creation was totally reversed, poverty and hunger increased. So this year we are recalibrating. So unlike last year, for instance, when we imposed the ECQ in the NCR Plus area, we did not close public transport. Mm-mm. Okay, we allowed as many workers to go to work as possible. Although we had a curfew, we exempted all workers. We even tried to exempt and fast track the delivery of all goods and services. So we are learning. Last year, we actually saw a lot of the businesses closed, even restaurants and dine-in. Yes. This year, we are seeing slowly some opening. So restaurants can open even during ECQ, but they have to do al fresco. Under MECQ, they can start with 10%. So in other words, what we are doing now is instead of shutting down the entire economy or a big part of it, we are managing the risk. We close down the sectors or the areas with the highest risk and allow 98% of the people with no COVID symptoms or risk to continue working. So that is what we're trying to do.
So, Secretary, given the 6.5 to 7.5% projection, I'm sure you've done the numbers with your team. If the NCR Plus bubble goes on MECQ for the rest of the year, will those numbers be reached? Just very quickly.
Well, no. we have to move out of MECQ by the end of the middle or the end of the month. We cannot be in MECQ for the entire year. Last year, we were in a combination of GCQ, MECQ, and ECQ. So we have to use this 2 months very wisely that we are in this bubble to enhance our PDITR strategy, the prevent, detect, isolate, treat, and recover, so that we can open the economy as soon as we can. And that is really the focus of the government right now.
I think you're making it very clear. So mid-May, what you're saying is ideally, will those numbers be achieved, that growth be achieved, if Metro Manila is on GCQ, or Metro Manila and NCR Plus has to be on MGCQ?
Well, we have to move out of MECQ. Have to go to GCQ and even better. And a big part of that, Karen, 95% is our own personal behavior. And everyone knows already what to do. Wash hands, you wear a mask and shield when you go out. You only go out to work or to buy essentials, and even wear a mask if you are living with comorbid or senior citizen. So all of us will have to cooperate to make this happen. It's not a magic solution that government or someone can just deliver.
Okay, but you said something. It's important to use the 2 months very wisely. Is the government actually doing that? Are they building the right infrastructure, changing the systems needed, testing more? In other words, here you are trying to make the economy open. It's like a balance. But are they doing that part? Are they up to par too?
Well, let me just share one thing. No? In NEDA, we are contributing to one of the strategy, and that is to provide automated contact tracing. You know, we have a manual system right now. And it takes 7 days actually from detection to isolation. If we can bring that down to from 7 days to 5.5 days, we would have reduced cases by more than half. So we are working on that. So instead of manually finding who are the direct contacts, NEDA, DOH, DILG, and some LGUs are working on a solution that will provide anyone who is a direct contact, if you use the apps, you know, the LGUs have contact tracing apps, we have a national Stay Safe Philippines app, you will get an automatic SMS. So that is one way that we are doing. And we have piloted that in 4 cities, Pasig, Antipolo, Mandaluyong, and Valenzuela. And we have recommended to the IATF to scale it up. The other concern that the DOH is focusing on is hospital capacity, beds. Yeah. ICU beds, isolation beds. So these two must be ready before we can open further. And I think there's a lot of progress already.
Okay. Now, do you believe the Philippines can be an economic driver? And I'll cite some examples that you just saw in some items now. Taking off from the local garments complaints that Chinese PPEs are given a preference, will you support putting in safeguards on imports as a way to support local industries, especially as Secretary, when it comes to PPEs, medical supplies, local counterparts with foreign counterparts?
Well, I have not studied the sector very well, but my principle is this. You know, if we can compete and we can offer the quality standard, then we should give our Filipino manufacturers some priority.
Correct.
Right now, you know,
preference.
But at the same standard, okay, we cannot sacrifice and risk the quality standards. You know, everyone needs a mask nowadays, and we also need the supply also. But if we can provide masks and other PPEs at the same standard as we have imposed on international, then by all means, we should give them some preference.
But because I'm curious, would a preference for local actually beef up the economy too to reach the 7.5% growth?
Well, yes. But also, as I mentioned, the standards are quite important. We don't want masks, of course, that do not really work. So correct. As long as we meet the standards, by all means, let us support our local industry.
Okay, another question here from a businessman watching, also with construction, right? Before it was only big projects that were allowed. Now you have, I think even residential can already go on. So local construction materials like steel and cement, would you support safeguards on preference for local, just to beef up the local industry once again?
Well, again, I would support if we provide the same quality standards. You know, in the end, it's not about only helping one industry. It's about ensuring the safety of all buildings and homes that we construct. Okay. The second one is, you know, we have 100 million people in this economy. We have to also offer them the best goods at the lowest or most affordable prices. Now, another point I want to make, Karen, is we made a decision in the IATF to open construction, even small-scale construction, even during ECQ. You know, last year, ECQ, construction is a no-no. Correct. Now, during ECQ, we allowed even the small scale, so long as they adhere to the health standards.
Okay, let's talk about now number two. You gave three conditions for the country to reach 6.5 to 7.5% growth target. Number one is essentially managing, right? Managing the pandemic and don't be too risk averse.
Correct.
And number two is the package, the recovery measures. We're in, there's 2.5 trillion pesos for the year as part of the government's three-pronged approach for economic recovery. Now, what are the problems and challenges for the 2.5 trillion pesos?
Well, let me just give you first the big picture. Uh-oh. So the total fiscal, monetary, and financial support that we have put in since last year is 2.7 trillion pesos. That is 15.4%. And this is a package that includes spending, tax breaks, that is through the CREATE, concessional or low interest and subsidized loans, and so on. No? So this is a package to address different concerns of businesses, because NEDA and the DOF conducted 8 or 9 surveys to understand better what are the concerns of the businesses and households. Now, our main constraint right now is to accelerate the implementation. You know, right now, we are operating on 3 budgets, okay? We have 2021 budget, we have the 2020 budget that wasn't fully used last year, and then we have the Bayanihan 2, which is extended until June. So, you know, the problem, I think, is not that we don't have sufficient resources. The constraint is more on getting things done faster.
So I'm sure you've brought that up in your IATF meetings, your meetings with the president. What is causing the delay in, a simple question, in frankly, just spending the money?
Well, you know, there are maybe 2 or 3 important reasons. Number one, we also have to remember, even before the pandemic, spending is not as fast, okay? Then we compound that with the pandemic and the ECQ or MECQ, which also slows down our ability to deliver. And finally, we are not yet leveraging on better technology to deliver. For instance, giving the ayuda or social amelioration, it's manual, but I hope by next year, once we're done with national ID, we can do it automated.
We'll talk about the national ID system in a bit also. Let's just move on to your third, so it's clear to the audience. The third condition is the deployment of the vaccination program. But did you make some allowance? Like, for example, you have the U.S. now not using J&J, so they'll be using more of their Pfizer and Moderna stocks, right? There's a bit of an issue with Astra in some countries, but we are negotiating Astra to arrive, the bulk of what was not used. Did you make an analysis if there's a, I mean, Secretary Galvez has a wish list of 70 million Filipinos vaccinated by the end of 2021. Do you see that as happening for Secretary?
Well, I think Secretary Galvez will be better able to answer that. But, you know, this is really part of our priority. You know, the biggest priority right now is to get the vaccination implemented as quick as possible. We are constrained not by our finances, but the supply, the global supply. And the spikes globally, not only in the Philippines, especially India, is causing the supply even to be more constrained. So we will have to be ready on our side so that when the supply do come, we can deliver them as soon as we can. Now, we are already starting priority A4. So A1 are the frontliners in health. A2, senior citizens, A3, those with comorbidities. And yesterday we started, or maybe May 1, we started with the A4 vaccination. So we have a plan that is ready and people are taking the vaccine. And once the supply comes, we have to be ready to deliver them as soon as we can.
Okay. I'm curious how many Filipinos need to be vaccinated just for us to reach 6.5% growth. I mean, just give me an idea. I know it doesn't have to be 70 million. Because now we're at 2 million vaccinated first dose.
Well, I don't know the exact number. We have to ask some of the health experts what level will achieve some level of health outcome. But 70 million is our adult population. That is the target. As many as we can vaccinate, and those that are vaccinated are being prioritized. You know, we are starting with those with the highest risk. So hospital workers, the health workers, once they are vaccinated, their risk of getting a severe case or dying is significantly reduced. So we provide confidence to the people. Number two, we have concerns about intergenerational families that we cannot send our children to school because they might bring home the virus to their grandparents. So we are vaccinating the seniors and then the comorbid. So this strategy, this very risk managed strategy, is actually, I think, going to improve confidence rather than just have it open to anyone.
But do you support the idea that if a bulk of the vaccines come, it should be the priority should be NCR plus, frankly, because it's the center of commerce and industry? You have some suggestions like that. And there are countries that are prioritizing the workforce first and the center of business.
Well, we have to look at the context of the country. And it's not just because NCR is an economic hub. It is also the center of this present spike. So that is where we have to allocate the available supply to where it is most needed. And that is really how we can move forward, by being more targeted so that we address the highest risk first before anything.
So you support that? You support a priority in NCR plus?
Because it is the highest risk.
Okay.
And we would support it elsewhere if the risks are also very high.
Okay. Now, moving on, let's talk about the last is the national ID system. So your goal is to have 70 million registrants for this. What happened first last weekend? Something happened to the website. There was a glitch. It wasn't accessible to many people. What happened?
Well, first of all, I would like to extend my sincerest apologies to the Filipino people for what happened. And there is no excuse for what happened. I take full responsibility, but I hope the viewers would care to listen to the story to give people some understanding. Well, you know, we started from zero last October, and as of today, we have registered 33.3 million to step one, which is the demographic. And we did this by going house to house to the low-income families. And we also registered 6.4 million to step two. Basically, all those who are pre-registered go to the registration center and provide their biometrics. Now, we thought because of the pandemic, we cannot have everyone fall in line, go to the registration center. So we developed an online system that was piloted last April 30. So it is a pilot, and the main reason for piloting it is to learn, and we learned a lot. What happened was the system was tested for 16,000 simultaneous users per minute with ability to scale up to 35,000 users per minute. But in the first minute, we saw 46,000 users.
Really?
So in other words, our capacity is not enough. The demand is so much, and we thank the Filipino people for patronizing and giving it importance. Now, what we do right now is to review our system so that we can increase the load. The problem is really the demand. It's like you open a new theme park or restaurant, although you are ready for the peak during holidays or weekends. Sometimes on the first day, just everyone wants to participate. And we thank them, but we are very sorry also for what happened. And we assure you, we are fixing this. We have experts all over the world, and we will relaunch it as soon as we can.
Okay, so right now it's closed, tama ba?
Right
today.
Now, it's actually still running, but only very few actually can enter. and complete. Actually, last weekend, on the first day, I think around 2,000 plus successfully went through the system. Those who are lucky enough not to be on the queue. So it's still open, but it cannot serve tens and tens of thousands. But we're hoping by the coming days, we will get back and serve more people.
All right. So what's shocking to me is without much effort, did you just say that almost 34 million Filipinos already registered for step one?
Well, there was a lot of effort. What I said is 33.3 million already registered for step one. So what happened during...
Why is it that the national ID is so popular that Filipinos go to step one to register and they don't want to get themselves vaccinated? Isn't that interesting?
I'm not sure that they don't want to get vaccinated. We have to show progress and the benefit. You know, when we started with national ID, the interest was very low. But what the PSA did was to go house to house since October 12th.
House to house.
Okay, so from October 12th to today, we registered 33.3 million house to house. And why did we do house to house? Because we cannot get them to fall in line in the registration center. That will violate social distancing. So when people register and they learn about the benefit, and more people want to be registered. And let me tell you one major benefit. One major benefit of the national ID is to give everyone a bank account. In fact, when you go to registration step two and provide your biometrics, you are able to open a bank account instantly because Land Bank is also there with us. And we have opened, I think, of the 6.4 million, half of them opened a bank account. So we are targeting one bank account per family by the end of the year, 100% financial inclusion, in other words.
Okay. And this national ID system, do you believe that it can help in, for example, the general contact tracing, general testing in the months to come?
Well, number one, on contact tracing, probably no, because there are confidentiality on the national ID. But for vaccination, yes, and we are working on that. When the general populations when it's a turn of the general population to be vaccinated, we intend to use a national ID as the way to queue them and to register them.
All right. Just very quickly before we go, some queries here. Would you be able to list just very quickly infrastructure projects ready for implementation before the end of President Duterte's term?
Well, there are two types of infrastructure. The infrastructure flagship projects. This is 104 projects that we monitor because these are big ticket items. And there are hundreds and even thousands of them that are smaller ones. That are in the 2021 budget. So of course, the 2021 budget, the 1.1 trillion infrastructure budget will have to be implemented in full because that is slated for this 2021. Now, of the 104, 75% of that is already implementation or pre-construction stage. So all of them will be implemented. Now, there are 25% that are going through government approval process. So once the process is complete, then we will be able to get it started and groundbreak before the end of the term.
But not one big one to be finished before Duterte steps down from office?
There are several. But I think Secretary Vince Deason, the flagship infrastructure advisor, can elaborate on that.
Okay. In terms of inflation, your support or your stand to lower tariffs on pork and higher minimum access volume, of course, this has received a lot of, frankly speaking, a lot of resistance from lawmakers. What's your response to this now? And in terms of a shift of policy?
Well, there are two priorities. The first is to help our domestic producers cope with African swine fever. And that is what the Department of Agriculture is focusing on. The second is to support 100 million eaters of consumers of pork who are facing one of the highest level of inflation on food and pork. You know, in NCR, it's 59% inflation in pork. Yeah. So our proposal tries to address both. We cannot have in this pandemic both an income shock and a price shock. So that is why we are proposing to temporarily, only temporarily, lower the tariff and increase the minimum access volume so that we can bring in enough food for the people. And at the same time, we will help the industry recover. There are, but the problem is we have seen the ASF for almost 2 years and our interventions are not enough. So we have to complement that with this temporary importation.
Oh, and you are standing, I mean, you are, kumbaga pinaninindigan mo, Secretary, the decrease in tariff?
The decrease in tariff.
There is no compromise?
The increase in the MAV and the reduction in the tariff are both needed. Now we are discussing with the Senate on a middle ground.
Okay, what is the middle ground for you in terms
of
that?
It is still being discussed.
Okay. All right. My last question before I let you go. Borrowings of 10.4 trillion pesos as of February this year. Do you think, you know, it's unprecedented borrowings. You have businessmen that are a bit worried with this. Is it still manageable, Secretary?
Well, since I'm not Department of Finance anymore, I think that is better addressed by DOF. Okay. And, you know, as an economist, we have set the foundation very strongly before COVID. We lowered our debt to GDP to the lowest ever of 39% of our GDP. And we increased our revenue to the highest ever in more than 20 years because of the tax reform. So these are important foundations that can help us achieve continuous fiscal sustainability. But for the details, I have to defer to DOF.
All right. On that note, Secretary Carl Chua, I want to thank you so much for your time
this
morning.
Thank you very much, Karen.
It's a lot of information. I hope to have you back on the show, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good day.